There's a new federal directive to help keep many renters in their homes for now.
Marketplace Morning Report is supported by The Wall Street Journal. The stories behind today's headlines have never been more important. The Journal podcast provides the facts. You can listen wherever podcasts are offered. And by X-Chair Office Chair, dynamic variable lumbar support and 10 ergonomic features for maximum support and comfort at xchair.com or 8444-X-Chair.
I'm David Brancaccio. The Trump administration last evening put out a directive to stop property owners from evicting some tenants amid pandemic. It'll take effect this Friday and runs through the end of the year. Marketplace's Nancy Marshall Genzer is here with details. Nancy?
David, the order is from the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. It prevents landlords from evicting tenants who can't pay. The tenants have to sign a declaration that they've tried to get government help to pay the rent, that they won't earn more than $99,000 this year for an individual or $198,000 for couples, and that they can't make rent payments because they've lost their job or had extraordinary medical expenses. And after the eviction moratorium lifts on December 31st, landlords can require tenants to pay all the rent that's due.
That's interesting, Nancy, that this is a CDC thing.
Yet the CDC says the rationale is if waves of people were evicted, they'd have to move in with other people or into shelters. That could lead to overcrowding and possible outbreaks of the coronavirus. The CDC says homeless people sleeping on the streets are also more vulnerable to help landlords so they don't default on their mortgages. But it's not clear how that would work. The administration also says there are funds in the CARES Act signed into law last spring that can be used to help landlords and property owners.
Nancy, thank you. Checking the markets, the FTSE index in London is up a lot, 1.7%. Here, Dow and S&P futures each up 0.7%. The NASDAQ future up 1%. Now to signing your life away when you go to college during pandemic. COVID-19 liability waivers, which students seem to be signing whether they want to or not. Here's Marketplace's Erica Barris.
Before she could start her classes at the University of Alabama, law student Haley Sarnick had to watch an online COVID-19 informational video. Halfway through, a document popped up for her to sign. It read that she agreed to wear a mask on campus.
But there was one little sentence, or not even a full sentence, half a sentence, buried sort of at the end of the first paragraph that said, I voluntarily assume.
Halfway through, a document popped up for her to sign. It read that she agreed to wear a mask on campus.
But there was one little sentence, or not even a full sentence, half a sentence, buried sort of at the end of the first paragraph that said, I voluntarily assume such risk.
Essentially, that means
no matter what the University of Alabama did, no matter how many precautions they took, you could get very sick or die.
Sarnick and others refused to sign that waiver. The university ended up changing the language. Before starting a semester, students have to sign off on all kinds of stuff. Dorm policies, a liability release for the gym, academic rules of conduct. Christopher Marsicano of the College Crisis Initiative says now they're having to sign COVID waivers too.
Trying to add additional restrictions and sort of provide them with an understanding that, you know, college may shut down and go all online, and that if students get sick, then it's not necessarily the college's fault.
Schools want students and staff to sign waivers like that because it's good for the bottom line, says Georgetown law professor Heidi Lee Feldman.
They don't have to spend as much money taking precautions against COVID-19.
For example, buying a new HVAC system for every building on campus. After all,
engineering solutions are more expensive than hand sanitizer and masks.
But it's not clear that any of these waivers would actually stand up in court. Alex Bloom, director of research at educational consulting company EAB, says contracts go both ways. Schools would have to show that they had completed all their COVID-19 preparations the way they said they were going to.
I think it will be very easy for a student who is trying to be held to this waiver to say, but you said you were going to do X and you did not.
But for now, students may not have a choice whether or not to agree to their school's terms. The University of Pittsburgh calls its liability waiver a community compact. Law student Julie Daw didn't sign it for 2 weeks. But then as the first day of her remote classes neared,
I did agree to the compact because I was concerned about losing access to, like, my school email, my school Zoom account, things like that.
Schools are hoping that's enough to persuade students to sign on the dotted line. I'm Erica Barris for Marketplace.
There are still no new negotiations scheduled for any new federal spending to help people get through the COVID collapse. Treasury Secretary Steven Mnuchin and House Speaker Nancy Pelosi spoke about this yesterday, but Pelosi says differences remain. Differences in the trillions of dollars, by the way. Friday, we'll get the August unemployment report that's forecast to be about triple what it was before the lockdowns.
Marketplace Morning Report is supported by Raymond James, tailored wealth management, banking, and capital markets solutions for clients' unique needs. Learn more at RaymondJames.com. And by Avalara, simplifying sales tax compliance with cloud-based solutions. Avalara automatically integrates with more than 700 of the most widely used ERP and e-commerce solutions. Avalara, tax compliance done right.
A new study from a car shopping app called Copilot finds that people now working from home have gained on average about 10% of their work week back. Marketplace's Andy Euler reports now that this adds up to serious cash.
Bill Isley says his commute in Central Texas before COVID was about 25 minutes each way. He knows that's relatively short. Oh, I should also tell you that Isley is a research engineer at the Texas A&M Transportation Institute.
So in 2017, each auto commuter was wasting $1,000 being stuck in traffic.
That's $1,000 a year for time and fuel. He says people like him who can work from home are saving that time and money.
I can't imagine how that doesn't continue to influence for quite some time.
For years, government policies have tried to encourage people to take public transit or commute in different ways. Elliot Martin at the University of California, Berkeley says now companies might develop new policies to encourage telecommuting.
I think the design of these policies potentially could receive new attention and new review based on what we've learned.
He says cutting out the commute also reduces gasoline consumption and CO2 emissions. I'm Andy Euler for Marketplace.
Hearing Euler there, I just did the math. I'm saving $271 in highway and tunnel tolls every month doing this thing from home. But some of that goes to pay electricity for the AC or the oil for the heating that has to be on all day now, right? I'm David Brancaccio. This is the Marketplace Morning Report. From APM, American Public Media.